Hi, my name is Krzysztof Dębski. I work for Allegro. I worked there for almost 9 years, so for the time I did a bunch of different stuff. And because now it's hype for machine learning, my boss decided that it would be good for me to learn that, and he decided that it would be good for me to go for the training. And I would like to tell you something more about machine learning, but not exactly about how to do machine learning, but how to do the organization and what we as the developers need to do to implement machine learning in our organizations. So basically, what is the machine learning? I found really nice tweet about this, and this is another buzzword. It is nice to say that I do machine learning if I'm at the conference and I want to tell you all that I'm really cool and my company is cool, so come to me, join me, and it would be nice. But actually, it is quite a good explanation what machine learning is and what machine learning is not. If you remember the most recent accident for the Uber car, the self-driving car, it was caused by all these three things that we have here, all these three buzzwords that we have here. We had machine learning that look at the pictures of the street and analyze it all the time and try to predict what might happen in just another second, whether there are going to be some people or not. It didn't try to understand what the people would do, but they want to try to understand whether they're going to be there. There was an artificial intelligence that tried to understand whether the people would go to the street and whether I need to stop. So that was the part just far away from the from machine learning. If we think about this, well, it would be easy if we see the person on the street and machine learning might think that we need to stop. Actually, it might be a policeman, it might be someone that stands next to the road, so we need the machine learning, the artificial intelligence there. And actually, there was an accident, so we needed that data science also to look at the insights why this actually happens. So these three different buzzwords are for totally different stuff, so we don't want to mix them. So basically, machine learning is the math. So what is so hard? What are the most common pitfalls that you might face when you want to implement machine learning? So the first pitfall before you try to implement machine learning is that you don't actually need machine learning for most of the problems that you have. The most common problem that we want to solve with machine learning is how to predict anomaly prediction, how to do anomaly prediction, and how to predict the outages. I have here the graph for the deal counts at Allegro. As you see, it is quite seasonal, so we don't need machine learning to know that every weekday morning we have some more deals than we have when people are on the lunch time. So basically, we just need to look at the data from the last week, and we would know what should happen today, and we can do some prediction for today. There's one more thing that we cannot why we cannot use machine learning here. We have just one single data series, so it's not like the crowd learning and using different sources to predict this single data data series. So what are the 10 pitfalls that I saw when we tried to implement machine learning? So the first one is we usually have some processes that are in our organization that we don't want to do. For example, fraud detection, spam detection, et cetera. So it would be great to have the magic wand to go from the manual work just right to the machine learning stuff. But actually, it can't happen. If you want to go to machine learning, you must pass the path to machine learning. There are some steps that need to be followed. For example, first of all, try to understand the process and build some stuff that would help you to do repeatable tasks. Then look at the data that you gathered and then try to implement it in the machine learning stuff. If you have this done, usually if you look at the data that you have, you might found that it's not really, really nice data. There is some survey that says that about 90% of the data in the enterprises are incomplete or just in mess. And frankly speaking, if you haven't looked at your data, they are in mess. So the first thing is that we, years ago, we tried to implement event-driven architecture. So we implemented events, but they were so messy and sometimes not readable from anyone that we need to change to the events that would be meaningful for machine, for meaningful for us. So if you have events that are really internal, it would be hard to build something on top of them. And even if you build business events, it might be hard to correlate them. In Allegro, we had the issue of how to find what we should, how to predict whether a person would click on the listing page, on the search page. It would be easy because we have like the path of the journey path for the customer. First, they go to the search page and then they go to the to the show item page. But actually, people opens a lot of different search pages in the browsers, so it's quite hard to know which exactly they clicked. Why it's hard? Because we don't have the correlation ID that can say exactly that the path was something like that. So it was hard to predict which search guide you to this particular show item. When we looked at the data, I tried to predict the incident or the outage time. And when I looked at the data, I had quite a good accuracy for this. It was surprisingly high, so I thought it's definitely not good for me. And then I looked at the data, and I found that most of the incident was caused by the SYN test, so it was specific. The time of this incident was specific for the one minute, and it misguided my machine learning model. So it just made the prediction for this particular data, and it made wrong predictions for all other data. So I looked again at this incident time, and I saw that there is a huge correlation between day and incident count. If you look at this, there's a huge correlation between weekday and incident count. So if there's a weekday, there's a huge probability that there are going to be some incidents. And I trained my model with this, and actually nothing good happened because it was extremely hard for me to predict whether the incident will appear in this particular minute. It's mainly because that not every weekday is the same as other weekday. As we see, every Wednesday at 1 p.m. is kind of Armageddon hour for us. I don't know why, but it's something like this. And every Thursday at early morning. So it's not like every day is the same. What might we see at the first chart? We need to cross the features day and the incident hour, and we need to have not separate set of features, but the cross one. So it was like 7 times 24 different features for this. Yep. And there's one more knife as a pitfall. When we had the data that we want to train our model, we usually provide to this model our bias that we have in our environment. There was a really bad incident for the Facebook when they bring their FaceApp application that made some silly things with the pictures. It added some glasses, etc., etc. But there was one specific filter that made them that gave them a lot of troubles. It was called hotness. If you want to make your picture hot, use this filter. But actually, the only single thing that the filter did was to make the face lighter. Why? Because the training set was the white people. So if you are white, if your face is lighter, you are hot. If you are black, it's kind of different, I think. So there's so basically, if we have that, there's some other thing with the goal for our project of machine learning. Recently, I read about last year Champions League final in Wales, in Cardiff, and there are a lot of different stuff that it's that the machine learning in Cardiff was so ugly that it identified more than 2,000 people, innocent people, as possible criminals. And it was like, oh gosh, it's like only 8% accuracy. Actually, it's journalists, so they were wrong. Accuracy was quite high because, of course, we thought about this 2,000 people that was blamed as to be criminals, but there was almost 200,000 people that was claimed that they are like the legitimate users and they are like okay people. And we have 173 criminals that was correctly recognized. So how we can, in that type of situation, how we can set up our goal? If we look at this data, it's like 99% of accuracy. So it was quite accurate. But still, we had some articles in papers that it's not accurate. Actually, it's not accurate the main goal. We have two different metrics. One is recall. It means how many criminals we have found. So it's like whether all the criminals that were in the crowd was found. And the second one is precision. So how many of the predicted criminals were actually criminals. So the line is usually like this. We can be here and treat every single person as a criminal. The recall would be zero because basically we found everything, every single criminal. And we can treat everyone as a normal user, and we don't find any single criminal. Actually, in the police this machine learning model, it was quite nice because the recall was 0.8%. So they have only the recall was 8%. So they have 2,000 people that was suspected to be a criminal that need to be manually reviewed. And it was like 2,000, not 200,000 people, what was everyone. So it was a really, really nice model. One more thing that machine learning is really nice, it's really good in correlation, but it's not good in causation. When I talked to my colleague recently, he said that it would be great to have a machine learning model that would say why the cause of the outage in our platform. We have almost 600 microservices, so if something goes wrong, it would be great to see the cause. Well, it's not that easy. Basically, when I wake up this morning, I had a little bit of headache, and I looked around. I found the conference badge, so I found the good correlation between conferences and headache in the morning. Actually, it was not the cause. I found the empty bottle of beer, that was the cause. So basically, it's easy to find correlation, but not causation. The same issue had Google with Google Flu Trends. They correlate 45 different search terms to flu epidemic. So basically, it was the correlation at the beginning was quite high, but they miss the huge flu in 2013, just because it was just a correlation and not causation. The search term hadn't caused the flu. Another pitfall that you might face is the information leakage. I tried to predict whether the incident in our system would be harmful or not. I said that harmful incident is the one that need to have engineer involved in the incident. And I found that if we have incident that lasts for 60 seconds or 120 seconds, 180 seconds, etc., they are usually automatically resolved incidents. So I found a good correlation between incident time and whether this is harmful or not. Well, it's good correlation, but that's the data that I won't have in the prediction time. In the prediction time, I'm right here. I know that the incident happened. I don't know when it would be resolved. Enough, if I know it, I don't need machine learning. So it's easy to find nice correlation that won't be available at the prediction time. If you think about machine learning, especially if you think about deep neural networks, they're extremely data hungry. There's really nice deep neural network, which is called Inception. Inception version 3 is actually the much more complex neural network than just DNN. But it's learned to understand what is on the picture, how to label the things. So if you have Android phone and face the image recognition application to Mac or to the computer, it would say that it's computer. But to understand those simple things, it needs an enormous amount of data. There's a really good labeled data set, which is called ImageNet. It has more than 14 million labeled images just to learn that we have different types of dogs and different types of things in our home. But actually, if you show them two different glasses, it cannot distinguish them. So we need enormous amount of data just to do really simple stuff in machine learning. Now, we can make it easier with transfer learning, with using some existing machine learning models in our problems. For example, we can use Inception version 3 to understand the images that are to understand what is on the image, and to learn it with our products, with our images that we want to predict. But actually, it doesn't work that well that we would like to see. If you saw the DeepMind that played Breakout, the Breakout is really easy game that came from Atari. It is like the small thing and the ball that we want to remove all the blocks from the top. And just after 4 hours of playing, this neural network learned that if you put the ball on the top, it would remove almost every single block, and it would be the best way to win the game. So just the 4 hours and great learn. But actually, the neural network doesn't understand that there's a tunnel here, and the ball is on the top, and because it's on the top, it should remove all of the blocks. It just understands that if it push the ball to the left side a lot of times, just after 10 or 15 times that it put here, the ball disappears, and then the points appears. So it's kind of easy. If you replace this thing with some other shape or height, it would fail completely. So that's not like understanding everything, but learning how to play this game. So to finish, when I started to learn machine learning, I thought it would be like this: a bit of engineering and 90% of math. Because if you go to Coursera and look at all these courses, there are a lot of math involved. But actually, what I saw, there is a lot of data engineering and some part of math involved. So if you want to incorporate machine learning into your organization, there's a lot of work that needs to be done, but not only in machine learning, but in the whole organization. Thank you for joining me here.